心情
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Welcome to another live program of Gems of the Heart, where we discuss what's important for us to purify our hearts with. Such an important subject, that something that we need to have every day in our life, something that we should really have the knowledge of when it comes to everything that we do. Since as a fact, it's a matter of fact, that anything that we do in this life affects our heart. Anything that we see affects our heart. Anything that we read, any action or any state that we indulge ourselves in, it affects our heart. The environment that we live in, the friends, the companions, relatives, where do we go? Where do we sit? How do we act? And so on and so forth. So therefore the matter needs knowledge and needs actions and patience to be able to practice what is very crucial and essential for us to make sure that our hearts are not polluted by whatever we see and we hear and so on. And there's nothing better than the Book of Allah and the Sunnah, the way the Prophet ﷺ. These are the means. This is how we get to know how to purify ourselves. And nothing is better also than to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the most important thing. That's the foundation for all good, is to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship Him alone. And we've been talking about the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how to have the proper belief in them and how to act according to these names and attributes as a way to purify our hearts. Many people, many Muslims, they do not know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His beautiful and perfect names and attributes. And as a result of that, you would find weakness and deficiencies in our ibadah, in our obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not just about some weaknesses or sins and so on. There is roots to this. There are diseases in the heart that would then become manifested in one's speech and actions. That's why if we cure our hearts from all of these diseases, if we purify our hearts with the proper belief, then it becomes so easy for the person to submit himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with acts of obedience. You know, really, we're supposed to be enjoying being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, وَجُعِلَتُ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِ فِي الصَّلَةِ. It's been made for me the comfort of my eyes and the jewel of my eyes in the salah. So this is how the salah was to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is something that we've heard from the statements of the companions radiallahu anhum, the early generations of Islam, how that the ibadah and seeking knowledge and striving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and doing good deeds and so on, it was their joy on the face of earth. How did they reach this level? It was something in their heart. Not something physical that necessarily that they didn't, even though these actions are physically done, but it because of what's in their hearts. And that's why we need to pay attention to this, and to be consistent and to be patient and to work on our hearts constantly with the remembrance of Allah. And again, as we said, with the proper belief. And to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the one that purifies the heart. One of the dua of the Prophet ﷺ, that he would say, Allahumma a'ti nafsi taqwaha, zakkiha, anta khayru man zakkaha, anta waliya wa mawlaha. That means, O Allah, give my soul, my nafs, my being, it's taqwa, to be among those who have taqwa and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Purify it. You are the one, you are the best one to purify it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that purifies the hearts. And that's why we need to seek that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we need to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes. And one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and one of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we need to be upon with matters of belief and actions and so on, is the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-baqi, which means the everlasting one. The everlasting one, al-baqi. And this meaning or this word al-baqi, something that we need to reflect upon, like all of the different names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Baqi, to understand it in the proper way, there's an opposite to it. And this is sometimes we have to understand things by knowing the opposite of it. بالضدي تظهر الأشياء, as they say in Arabic. When you see, when you want to understand something, get to know the opposite of it. You would see how perfect it is. Like for example, one of the ways to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to see ourselves. We would see how weak we are. And then we would see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most powerful. So the opposite of al-baqi is al-fani. Al-fani means the perished ones, or the things that goes away. It vanishes. This is the opposite of the everlasting one. So when we think about what is going to vanish, what is going to be perished, what's not everlasting, what is it? We would find our wealth, our health, the life on the face of earth, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that takes life and gives life after this life. So people will die. Everybody will die on the face of earth. Everything shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then people will be resurrected in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-baqi, is the everlasting one that never vanishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a matter of belief, and of course that constitutes certain actions to be applied in our life. But this beautiful concept, if we have the proper understanding of it, it's something that's supposed to be a life-changing. First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about himself subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. And this is in Surah Ar-Rahman, this beautiful surah that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Part of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَان. And that's the word fani. Everything upon the face of earth and everything in the creation of Allah will be perished. Fan, that means perished, vanishes. وَيَبْقَى, وَيَبْقَى comes from the word al-baqi comes from it. And that means, and the one that stays forever. وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, the face of your Lord, owner of majesty and honor. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-baqi, everything will vanish. Is there actions to be done as a result of this? Of course. And this is basically our job on the face of earth, to make sure that we are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you would find that it's a source of happiness really on the face of earth to have this proper belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He is al-baqi. Don't rely with your heart on anything that is vanishing. You know, when we talk about vanishing, that means anything that vanished. Don't fear a human being. This human being will die one day. And they return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they need to answer Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why should you be that much concerned in a way that a person would end up as if he's worshipping this other human being, fear him so much more than he fears Allah, that would make him disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the right way because of the fear of this deficient human beings. And that's a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A human being, a person would think that he has means of provisions for you. No, he doesn't. So if your boss at work, if your job, whatever there is, would want from you to commit a sin, to disobey the creator of the heavens and the earth, otherwise they won't give you your paycheck or they'll fire you or whatever there is. Who is the one that we're supposed to have the fear of? The one that is al-baqi, the everlasting one, or those who will vanish? They will vanish. They do not even own anything. They're not the sustainers, they're not the providers. Their affairs is under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a matter of belief. And if a person has this certainty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for him. And one of the basic, very basic means of intellect, if we really reflect upon this, this is something that the people of knowledge mentioned. Something Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentioned these beautiful words of wisdom. And I would like for you to pay attention to this because it really changes lives. He said, and I would say it in Arabic and then translate it inshallah ta'ala. He said, مَتَ رَأَيْتَ الْعَقْلِ يُؤْثِرُ الْفَانِي عَلَى الْبَاقِي فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ قَدْ مُسِخْ. Which means once you see العقل, the intellect of a person, give preference or priority or precedence to الْفَانِي, to what perishes, over the everlasting one, then know with certainty that this aql and this certainty and this intellect has been corrupted. It's been distorted. It's not upright anymore. One of the basics, what he's basically saying, one of the basic characteristics of one's reason and one's intellect, if you have something that is everlasting and something that is not everlasting and vanishes, if you ask anyone on the face of earth, does it need to be a PhD in whatever science there is, just ask a simple question to a human being. Which one would you prefer? The everlasting one or the one that is vanishes? Any human being would say the everlasting one, because that's an everlasting one, never ends. But the one that ends, you know, after some time it's going to go away. So if you choose that over the everlasting one, that means you have something wrong with your mind, that you have something wrong with your own intellect. So this is a fact. Therefore, a human being, a wise human being, should build on this fact, other facts, and it goes on and on. Do not contradict yourself. So that's why how the matter of belief, faith, works with our speech and actions. So then, what's everlasting and what's vanishing? What's everlasting? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of the creation of Allah vanishes. And for the human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect them. And they will be everlasting living in Jannah or the hellfire, all by the power of Allah. Also, when we see that the life that we live in, this earth, will vanish. So is it really valid for a person to live his life fighting over the materialistic things of this life that is going to vanish? Or should he be more concerned over the everlasting one, which is the hereafter? And that's the message of the Quran. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us in the Quran. We are living on the face of earth for a limited time. No one knows when he's going to depart from this life. And therefore the Prophet ﷺ, when he said, كُنْ فِي الدُّنْيَا كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيبٌ أَوْ عَابِرُ سَبِيلٌ, be in this dunya, in this life, like you're a stranger or a wayfarer. And Abdullah ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما, he would say after this hadith, إِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَتَنْتَظِرِ الْمَسَاءِ وَإِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَتَنْتَظِرِ الصَّبَحِ. If you wake up in the morning, don't wait for the evening. And if you the evening comes, do not wait for the morning. That means the matter can be at any time. So be always prepared to go to the everlasting life. This life that you live on the face of earth is not an everlasting one. It's something that you have to leave behind. So what does that mean? What's that entitles for the person to do? Does that mean that we just quit doing everything and just we wait for the moment of death? Of course not. But it means work and work hard and strive and be extremely busy on the face of earth. But for what intentions? For the intention of seeking the rewards in the hereafter. So you would find the believers, they would learn matters of deen so that they would know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them. They would fulfill the obligations, pray the five daily prayers, the sunnah prayer, option acts of worship, staying away from haram. The life is the deen and observing the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore for them to establish the deen perfectly like that, matters of belief and worship and manners and so on, they have to seek provisions from Allah, they have to work, they have to plan, they have to manufacture, they have to do whatever they do in the most perfect way. Hearts are attached to the hereafter, they put things in the right perspective. They won't disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of these materialistic things, because it's not a goal, it's a mean. And that's what makes matters very clear intellectually. So when a person thinks this way, then we would put forward an everlasting thing over what vanishes. And we can go on and on with this. You know, something like the salah. When we look at the ummah and the status of the ummah today, where are the Muslimin from the masajid and the houses of Allah? The houses of Allah, for the most part, is not filled and full of the Muslimin because they're busy seeking provisions from Allah. Is that the right way that we should understand our deen? Or we would rather, you know, fulfill the orders of Allah. A person would say, but during the day people are working, that's fine. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, وَجُعِلَتْ لِيَ الْأَرْضُ مَسْجِدًا وَطَهُورًا. The earth is made for us as Muslims, a place of salah and a place of purification. If you don't find water, you make tayammum. And you pray whatever you are, in whatever place you are, far away from the masjid, you pray and so on. If you have Muslims with you, then definitely you pray jama'ah and so on. But then how about Fajr salah? How about Isha salah? when you have the masajid, of course, if a person is working next to the masjid and so on, they go to the masjid. But where is the masajid when you are at home? When a person would choose the vanished one over the everlasting one. When the time for the salah comes, a person does not fulfill the orders of Allah. When dealing with haram, when not observing the orders of Allah. When you find, for example, you go to the major cities among the Muslim world, would you see people observing the deen of Islam the way they ought to be? Where is the proper hijab, for example? This is the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the Muslim women, to observe the hijab. And this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in hereafter. So when a Muslim woman does not obey the orders of Allah, and rather imitates the ways of the disbelievers and so on, she is choosing the vanishing one over the everlasting one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he called the wives of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and he gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam the order to give his wives this choice. يَا نِسَاءَ النَّبِيُّ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ إِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِيدْنَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَزِينَتَهَا فَتَعَالَيْنَ أُمَتِّعْكُنَّ وَأُسَرِّحْكُنَّ صَرَاحًا جَمِيلًا وَإِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِيدْنَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَالدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَعَدَّ الْمُحْسِنَاتِ مِنْكُنَّ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. O Prophet of Allah, say to your wives, if you want the life of this dunya, the life of this world, and its adornment, come and I will set you free. That the Prophet ﷺ would divorce them and set them free, and they will have the pleasure of this life. If you are seeking the pleasure of this life and the adornment of it, فَتَعَلَيْنَا أُمَتِّعْكُنَّ وَأُسَرِّحْكُنَّ صَرَاحًا جَمِيلًا. It's going to be a beautiful release. It's not going to be harmful. It's not going to be painful. It's going to be according to what you desire. But then, وَإِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِدْنَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, if you are want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, وَالدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ, here it is, وَالدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ, and the hereafter, the everlasting one, then indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared, أَعَدَّ, prepared لِلْمُحْسِنَةِ مِنْ كُنَّ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا, to the good doers among you, a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know what the choice that they took. Prophet ﷺ, after staying away from his wives for a month, he went to them and he started with Aisha radiallahu anha. And he recited this verse to her, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering me to give you that choice. And of course she said that I choose Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the hereafter. And the rest of the wives of the Prophet ﷺ followed the same answer. They gave the same answer. And therefore, they are with the Prophet ﷺ in Jannah for an everlasting life. They are the wives of the Prophet ﷺ in this life and in the hereafter. And how long they lived on the face of earth, and how long they have been returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how many years? And the same thing when we depart from this life. So the matter is a very basic intellectual principle, really, that a person would put forward the everlasting meaning over the things that vanishes. And this has been mentioned many times before, but when we look into the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, their entire life was about this. If it was about this life and the materialistic things of this life, you would find the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ totally different. You would find the verses of the Quran totally different. But the subject is about the hereafter. It's about doing things now on the face of earth, seeking the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. This will put things, the entire life of a Muslim will be in the proper way. If we just fix that one understanding and one perception, to put forward the everlasting one over the vanishing things and so on. The Prophet ﷺ entering on Aisha radiallahu anha, and they had a sheep that they slaughtered, and they gave it all. She gave it all in charity, except the arm. She kept that for the Prophet, the shoulder. She kept that for the Prophet ﷺ. So when the Prophet ﷺ entered, he asked a simple question that has also the same meaning of al-baqi. He said about this sheep, مَا بَقَى مِنْهَا, what has been left from it, baqa, what's left and not been given away, what's not been perished. So Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, مَا بَقَى غَيْر كَتِفُهَا, nothing has been left except its shoulder. The shoulder is the only thing that is left. So the Prophet ﷺ corrected her, radiallahu anha, even though she said exactly what it is, it's only the shoulder is left. He said, بَقِيَ كُلُّهَا غير كتفها, which means all of it had stayed forever except the shoulder. This is what perishes. Why? Because the shoulder is going to be eaten and it perishes, it vanishes. But what stayed forever is what's given in charity. This is what stays forever. This is the perception. This is the matter of belief. This is the benefit of having these meanings in one's heart. Aisha radiallahu anha, she did not say anything wrong. The Prophet corrected, perfected the understanding of it so that things will be done in the right perspective. The Prophet والسلام, he said that the son of Adam, he says, Mali, Mali, my wealth, my wealth. And then the Prophet said, then Ibn Adam, O son of Adam, هل, your wealth that you have, is it anything but ما أكلت فأفنيت, what you eat and it perishes. فأفنيت, perishes. And what you wear, فأبليت, وما لبست فأبليت, what you wear and it becomes bad and old and you throw it away. This is your wealth. What's your wealth? What you're using your wealth for? You buy food with your wealth and you eat it and it vanishes. You buy clothing, whether it's expensive or cheap or whatever there is, and it vanishes. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, وَمَا تَصَدَّقْتَ فَأَمْضَيْتَ, and what you gave charity, and that stayed. So this is what stays. What stays is what you send to the hereafter. Someone that has two houses, one here and one in another city, and he, whenever he gets money, he uses the money that he is needed for this place that he's renting. He's renting now, and he owned another house in another city. And he is getting himself ready to move to this other place. So he is, whatever money he comes to him, he's using it for his necessities, and he's sending the money to the other city to build it, to perfect it, and so on, for his return to it, because this is his ownership. He's not wasting his money. It's the same thing when a person gives in charity. You're not, your money is not vanishing. It's not decreasing. It's being sent to the hereafter to build your everlasting life. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. We'll continue inshaAllah ta'ala with this beautiful concept of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the name Al-Baqi, the everlasting one, after the break. So stay with us inshaAllah. Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalam, rasulullah. Welcome back. And we're talking about Al-Baqi, the everlasting one. And by the way, this is not necessarily as one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as some said, that there's no evidence clearly that this is one of the names of Allah, but definitely one of the attributes of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the everlasting one. As we heard in the verse, وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, that what stays forever, the face of your Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The concept again of what's everlasting versus the opposite of it, which is vanishes, and how this can be a life changing, and how it purifies the heart, not to heart, to have the heart attached to what vanishes. Anything that goes away, don't give it so much of your attention and your heart and your concerns and your happiness and sadness and so on. Let it pass by at ease. But rather the things that stays forever, this is what you need to give it your concern. And that's why the Jibreel alayhi salam, he said to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Ya Muhammad, أحبب من شئت فإنك مفارقه. O Muhammad, love whoever you love. One day you'll depart from them. They're not going to be with you forever. Death takes people apart. And he said to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, وَعْمَلْ مَا شِئْتْ فَإِنَّكَ مَجِزِيٌّ بِهِ. And do whatever you do, you will be rewarded or recompensed for it. And that's what matters. So even when it comes to those who are loved ones to you, when a person think of his mother, his father, his wife, his children, one day will come and you will depart from them. They will die before you, you will die before them. It doesn't matter. Someone will die before the other. And everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before we continue this concept, we have a phone call. Brother Muhammad, Sister Umm Muhammad from Oman. Assalamu alaikum. Go ahead, inshallah, sister. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Umm Muhammad from Oman.
Hello?
Yes.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead, sister. Yes, I can.
I'm not sure if you can hear me, Sheikh, but I cannot hear you. My question is, Aisha radiallahu anha is the mother of all Muslimin. Why, when she was talking with the men, she had to talk behind the curtain? If she is our mother, is the mother of everyone, why she has to talk behind the curtain? So I don't know whether you heard me or you have not heard me. But
I heard
you. Switch on the TV and I'll see to answer my question, please.
Sure, inshallah. Yes, I heard you, inshallah. So before we continue answering this question, Aisha radiallahu anha, the mother of the believers, Ummul Mu'mineen. So if that's the case, why when she would speak to strange men, she would speak from behind a curtain? First of all, Aisha radiallahu anha and the wives of the Prophet ﷺ are the mothers of the believers. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَتُهُمْ. That means the wives of the Prophet ﷺ are the mothers of the believers. And the way to understand this is also from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. The normal way that the mother would deal with her children is that she does not observe hijab in front of them. But this is a special motherhood, if it's correct to say, by the statements of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Because also in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, including Aisha radiallahu anha, to speak from behind a curtain or behind a veil. وَإِذَا سَأَلْتُمُهُنَّ مَتَاعًا فَاسْأَلُهُنَّ مِنْ وَرَاءِ حِجَابٍ. If you ask them for anything, ask them from behind a veil or a curtain. And that's to the wives of the Prophet ﷺ and the entire Muslim women, Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ. Whenever you ask them from behind a veil and not just something special for the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. So by the statement of the Quran, this does not contradict the fact that she is the mother of the believers. The mother of the believers, that means it's not permissible for anyone after the Prophet ﷺ to marry them, for example, or to marry the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. There are the mothers of the believers to learn from them, to benefit from them, to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them and so on. And when it comes to matters of these rulings, it's by mentioned in the Quran and so on, is to observe these limits as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in the Quran. So it's not basically similar exactly to all of the physical motherhood between a mother and a child. Nobody can touch, of course, or do the things that he would do with his mother. This is by the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, still a stranger to them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them to observe these things. And this is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, going back again to the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-baqi, is the one that is everlasting one. And putting forward this over anything that is vanishes, and how this is a life changing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran this concept. And to put forward, as we said, the actions. The actions, even in relationships, like your loved ones, you have a mother or a father, or a wife or children and so on, you will depart from them one day. And therefore what stays is your actions towards them. That means when a husband is kind to his wife, or a wife is kind to her husband, or the love that is there between them and the parents and so on, what stays forever, if it's for the sake of Allah. If people would make this love for the sake of Allah, that they do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of these relationships. When a husband disobeys Allah because of the love that he has towards his wife or towards his children, that he would make him earn haram, for example, and the like of this, this becomes enmity in the Day of Judgment. They would curse one another in the Day of Judgment, even though they used to have so much love towards one another. This is in the temporary life. If you want it for it to continue forever, make it based on the obedience of Allah, even if they're angry with you. Even if they don't like you because you are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's better for you this way so that the everlasting life, then if they become obedient to Allah, they would have the real love and the real liking and so on, because it's an everlasting one. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, Al-akhillau ba'duhum yawma'idhin li ba'din adu illa al-muttaqin. Al-akhillau, those who reach the highest level of love and friendship and goodness, very close to each other, the highest level, they will be, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, enemies to one another. So all of this love and care and concern that they had on the face of earth, it is replaced by enmity in the day of resurrection, illa al-muttaqin, except those who have the taqwa and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, this is the concept of thinking and believing in the everlasting one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentioned in the Quran something in the same roots of the word, al-baqiyatu salihat. As we said, al-baqi means the everlasting one. There is something called al-baqiyatu salihat. As-salihat means the righteous ones. Al-baqiyat means the everlasting righteous things. What is the everlasting righteous things? Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, it's all amal salih, any righteous good deeds that a person do for the sake of Allah, seeking the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. This is al-baqiyatu salihat. But first of all, where is this mentioned in the Quran? This is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Kahf and Surah Maryam. In Surah Al-Kahf that we recite every Jumu'ah, and it's a light from one Jumu'ah to the other, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-malu wal-banuna zinatul hayati dunya, wal-baqiyatu salihatu khayrun inda rabbika thawaban, wa khayrun amala. Which means, Al-malu wal-banun, wealth and offsprings. What about wealth and offsprings? Zinatul hayati dunya, the adornment of this life, nobody can deny. But the zina is the outside appearance of things. That means it doesn't really stays forever. So wealth and offsprings are the zina, the adornment of this life. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتِ. And what stays afterwards, what stays forever, al-baqiyat, plural, الصالحات, the righteous ones, the righteous everlasting things or deeds, خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ أَمَلًا. Better by your Lord, thawaban in rewards, and better amalan, hope. This is the best hope. When you have so much hope with regards to your wealth and your offsprings and your children, it's nothing wrong, but as long as your heart is not too much attached in this when it comes to materialistic matters. The real hope and the real everlasting hope is what's with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. So if this wealth that you have on the face of earth is not going to be something that you will be pleased with in the hereafter, that means this is a source of curse and misery. If the offsprings that you have, your concern towards them is to make them, or to have them righteous offsprings, to make them obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is what matters for you the most, then they become a source of misery. It's not about this life, it's about the hereafter. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directing our hearts to be attached to the everlasting ones. Therefore, dealing with your wealth, dealing with your children, with whatever it is in your life, should be with that concept, that you seek in the rewards of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that also in Surah Maryam, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَزِيدُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْ هُدَى وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ مَرَدًّا. Which close and similarities here to the previous verse, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَزِيدُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْ هُدَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase those who are guided, more guidance. وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتِ, the righteous everlasting things, deeds and dhikr, as we would see also from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ, it's better by your Lord. And the significance of عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ, by your Lord, this is what everybody shall return to. And it's going to be the everlasting one, not going to be a temporary one. خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا, reward-wise, وَخَيْرٌ مَرَدَّ, and better in the مَرَدَّ, the outcome of it, the final result of it. Because everything in this life is going to go away, and what stays forever is what really matters. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to have our hearts attached to the hereafter. And this is what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and he's the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him as mercy to mankind. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you except for a mercy to mankind. He's the one that concerns him so much, this ummah, and wants the best for it. The Prophet his life and inviting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants the best for his ummah. He used to say what alayhi salatu wasalam, أَكْثِرُوا ذِكْرَ هَذِي مِنْ لَذَّتِ, which means frequently mention the destroyer of desires, death. This is not something that people are pleased with. The people, those who indulged into the materialistic things of this life, they don't want to frequently mention death. It makes them not very pleasant and have long hope and so on. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that from us. And this is something that brings joy on the face of earth, joy with being real, not joy and being intoxicated. Joy with the fact that you know that you'll die anytime. This is another point. If you know that, as one gave the example, if you're sitting in the comfort of your home and you know that an enemy will come and attack your home and will kill you, but you do not know when, and it can be any moment, would you sit in a very comfortable and very secure way? Would you be able to be happy and in tranquility and so on? Probably not. Why? Because at any moment, this enemy will come and attack you and kill you and so on. This is the same way when it comes to death, but we're not supposed to live our life, you know, terrified. Of course not. But the point is here, anytime death can come, whether it's in the morning or in the evening or next day, after a month, after a year, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Nobody knows exactly when the moment of death will come. So therefore, knowing this as a fact, and you want to be happy, you want to still continue to be in state of joy and tranquility and comfort and so on, it would never happen if you have this fact as a knowledge and certainty with matters of death. You would never receive really the real happiness if you keep on having this understanding that you can die anytime, unless you are working for the baqiyat al-salihat, unless you would work for the everlasting righteous actions and so on, unless your heart is attached to the hereafter. You would live a goodly life, you will be the most productive person on the face of earth, and at the same time you won't be terrified and ruining your life because of these facts. Otherwise, when we say people understand and they know that they will die anytime, but why they're not living in a life of being misery and so on? Because they're intoxicating themselves, because they keep on forgetting this, and they indulge in whatever they do in this life thinking that they would live forever. And then the moment of death comes and people, you know, maybe get a lesson from the one that died, but then life goes on and nobody care about this poor guy that died and he did not prepare himself for it. So the point here is to be real and to be aware of the reality of this life, is to understand this concept of al-baqi. And that's where the hearts need to be attached to. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, when it talked about the baqiyat al-salihat, it mentioned a dhikr, which is subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. This dhikr, as some call it, the fourth kalima, but it's subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. This is al-baqiyat al-salihat. The Prophet ﷺ called it al-baqiyat al-salihat, the righteous everlasting ones. As we said, it's all good deeds that is done for the sake of Allah in the hereafter, seeking the rewards in the hereafter. But also this specific action is one of the clear examples of al-baqiyat al-salihat, dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, as the hadith of Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu reported by al-Hakim and others, where the Prophet ﷺ one time, and again as the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, he corrected her perception with regards to the sadaqah and the charity. Listen to this one, it has the same concept. The Prophet ﷺ said one day to the companions radiallahu anhum, خُذُوا جُنَّتَكُمْ, which means take your shield, protect yourself. As the Prophet ﷺ said, that as-sadaqah burhan, and he said as-siyamu junnah. Fasting is junnah, fasting is a shield. So he said, خُذُوا جُنَّتَكُمْ, take your protection, protect yourself. So the people, they replied to the Prophet ﷺ, is it an enemy coming? Should we take protection because the enemy is coming? The Prophet ﷺ, he said, لا, no, there's no enemy coming, but take your protection from the hellfire. Protect yourself from the hellfire that is coming. So he said to them, say, subhanallah, walhamdulillah, ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. This is your shield from the hellfire, and this is الباقيات الصالحات. That's what stays with the person forever. He said the same thing to Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu when he was planting a ghiras, something of vegetation that he was planting, which is nothing wrong with that, it's a good thing. But the Prophet ﷺ told him, should I inform you of a better ghiras, a better thing to plant in this life? And he said to him to say this, subhanallah, walhamdulillah, ولا إله إلا الله, Allahu Akbar, you're planting a plant that would stay forever. The plants in this life is temporary. Does it mean that you leave it, do not do it? No, do it. But put it in the right perspective, why you're doing it, to eat, to have strength, so that you would work for the everlasting one. but you make it a goal in itself, you're distorting the understanding of what's al-baqi from al-fani, what's everlasting from what's perishing. So therefore, when you plant in the hereafter, like when you say Subhanallah al-Azim wa bihamdih, as the Prophet ﷺ said in Surah Abi Dawood, this is a palm tree in Jannah. When a person would say La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, that's a treasure in Jannah. This is what you are sending to the hereafter for that everlasting one. And we would see how much time in our life we are wasting when we don't make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we don't seek protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by being obedient to Allah. Just the fact that when a person, we mentioned this, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, when he explained the meanings of it, he said, La hawla an ma'asiyatillah. That means no turn away from the sin and disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا قُوَّةَ عَلَى طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And there's no strength to have to be obedient to Allah except by Allah. So that's why it's a treasure in Jannah. So if you want to change from the state of sin, you need the help from Allah. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely. Make dua to Allah. Say, لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. I cannot turn from that state to the other except by the power of Allah. وَلَا قُوَّةَ. And there's no strength that I can have to be obedient to Allah. No strength to make dhikr. No strength to make salah. No strength to give charity. No strength to do this or this and so on, except by Allah. So you would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely, with dua, with the heart to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is what everlasting, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the everlasting one. So we end with this inshallah ta'ala, and I hope that this is benefiting, and to remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the everlasting one, and anything returns to Allah, then it's an everlasting one. But anything that is not done for the sake of Allah, rather than even being even a sin, it's something that would bring all kinds of miseries and sadness. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the proper understanding and to make us among those who are steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Until next time, with another name and attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I leave you with the protection of Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
You're living in a lawful way. Be mindful of what you say. Be sincere when you pray. Today could be your last day. Bear each other no malice. Greed and faith can coexist in the same home.